Hi viewers, welcome back to Sahara TV. Once again, my name is Adeola Fayon. This is our highlight segment where we are going to talk today about how the media in Nigeria has been covering the flood that has been going on for quite some weeks now. And to talk to us today about this are two wonderful journalists from Nigeria, Ahoma Kanu and Idris Akinbanjo. Ahoma Kanu is the winner of the Tourism at CNN Multi-Choice African Journalist Award 2012. He is a social crusader, a media and publicity coordinator at the Down Syndrome Association of Nigeria. He's also the assistant editor and head for the Entertainment and Arts Desk at the National Daily News. Ahoma Kanu, welcome to Sahara TV.
Thank you, Adio.
Also, I'm doing good. I also have Idris, and he's a Lagos-born journalist who does political stories. He exposes corruption in government. He's a reporter and head of the investigative desk for Premium Times. And he's the winner of the Young Person of the Year Award, the winner of the African Investigative Journalist of the Year, Nigerian Investigative Journalist of the Year, and a finalist for the 2012 CNN Multi-Choice African Journalist. Idris, welcome to Sahara TV.
Thank you very much.
All right. So we want to talk about how the media in Nigeria has been covering the flood, which is still going on, by the way, because we feel like there has been some lacking in how they are covering the flood, that they could do more. So if you guys can shed some light as to the challenges that the media in Nigeria has been facing, which has caused some drawbacks in how they've been covering the flood. So I want to start with you, Ahoma. Can you tell me some of the challenges that the media is facing in Nigeria as far as covering this flood is concerned?
Well, thank you, Adeola. I would speak from a personal experience. And you see, we are talking about the flood now because it's going on. But this is something that was predicted. Nimet predicted this as far back as in February this year. But you see, the Nigerian media, we are just kind of biased towards politics. You know, I would keep talking about politics, but environmental issues, as far as I'm concerned, we the journalists, we the media, did not give adequate attention to the predictions made by Nimet. And that is where the problem started. You know, it has happened now, and we are still not covering it enough. So many media organizations will not have that, you know, the money to send you out there. You don't have choppers. Some of us don't have, you know, vehicles to take you there. You don't even have an insurance, you know, to take you there, despite the dangers inherent there. And the challenges are enormous. But we're still trying to do the job to the best of our abilities, and we'll still keep doing it.
Idris, do you think that it's the editors or people, the top level people in these media houses, do you think they are the ones that are not passionate about covering the flood, or is it the journalists that are trying to avoid it, or is it about money, as Ahoma has said?
Well, I think it's a combination of all the factors. It's a combination because, just as happening all over the world, there is a shrinking budget in most newsrooms. Given the practical example from Premium Times, for you to cover adequately the flood in all the states involved, you would have to have at least two or three reporters in each of these states. Very few media houses have the budget to be able to maintain reporters in all the states that the floods are happening. Then, secondly, yes, like Alma said, there is a bias by the Nigerian media towards politics and stories that don't directly acting effect on the masses, on the poor people of Nigeria. So that was also a factor. But I think the main reason that has affected the reporting, at least from the angle of Premium Times, despite the fact that we have tried our best, is the fact that to maintain reporters in all the states and virtually all the local government, the flood is happening, it involves a huge budget. And many media houses, the few credible media houses in Nigeria do not have such a budget to do so.
Idris, before you go on, I know that the two of you guys have been covering this flood, but there are so many things that are still not clear. Can you just tell us how many states are actually affected, and also how many people have died and the number of people in camps, because we still don't know. Idris,
I'm saying
that, yeah, the number of states. Do you know how many states are actually affected?
It's been reported that about 22 states are affected. So the degree of flooding in these states varies from state to state.
Okay.
In some states, you have just a couple of local governments affected. Like in those states, you have just three local governments. In some states, there are some states in the north that experience their own flooding, not because of the rains, really, but because of the large gas issue. Those states had the problems long before the rain started falling in mass. And so overall, you have about 22 states affected by the flood.
So what about casualties? What about casualties? How many people died and how many people are in camps?
The number of people in camps, it's difficult to give you a specific number of people in camps. I'll give you a reason for that. Now, in reporting the floods, we work with emergency agencies a lot, outside the National Emergency Agency and the Red Cross. And yet, even they tend to update their statistics on a daily basis. I remember talking to the South Regional Coordinator of NEMA a couple of days ago about the number of people that are actually present in River State camp. Because a few days before, a few days earlier, he had told us that there are 40,000 people at the camp. But a couple of days ago, the deputy governor of the state said that by their own calculation, they had about 80,000 people in the camp.
Hmm.
So I threw the question at him to say, how many people are actually in the camp in River State? And he said, because it's updated on a daily basis, on an hourly basis, it doesn't have a specific figure right now. So it's difficult saying how many people are affected right now. Though the Red Cross has to be casualties. I think the last figure we got from the Red Cross was about 140.
Okay, so
that's about over a week ago. So unless only the emergency agencies can give accurate figures of those in all the camps.
Okay, right, so Ahoma, you just had Idris saying that it's difficult to know the number of casualties. I mean, how does that make you feel as a journalist and you're covering this and you don't even know the number of people that are on campsites? I mean, they're telling him different numbers. The state government is giving a different number. The emergency management people are giving a different number. What is going on? Why isn't this clear? Because in other countries like in the U.S., they keep tab of all these things. What is missing? Why can't we know the number of people that are affected?
I'll tell you, Adeola, I agree with what Idris said because there are so many abnormalities going on here. You know, see, I went to some of the camps, and first of all, documentation is not really there. You know, today they will tell you, they're just giving us estimates, not really what they have on ground, you know. And again, it's very, very difficult to say because some camps just, you know, they just walk in there and people walk in there and walk out, you know, and it's just very difficult to kind of find out exactly how many people are there. But the case of death, you know, it keeps trickling, coming in. Now, are we talking about people that have died because of the flood or people that have died because of the diseases, you know, and all these, you know? It's just difficult. And again, when I went to some of the camps, you know, I was trying to talk with the camp organizers, and they are kind of trying to hide something, you know. They wouldn't even want some of the victims to talk to you and all that. You know, they keep shielding as if they are hiding some things. And we are supposed to be working together, you know. So those are some of the challenges. I don't think that we can even get a holistic, you know, statistics. What we are just being fed, you know, maybe some of them, like when I went to the camp at Central School at Odebe in Elbaru in Anambra State, you know, that's one of the worst camps I visited because there was no camp command, no camp or coordinator there, you know. And the people were just sleeping, or some of them were on the floor. Some of them, I saw a woman with a 4-month-old baby lying down on a bench, you know, old people. And this, I will tell you that the majority of people that are kind of affected are women and children. The men, you know, come in and go, but women, and especially old women and children, they are still the ones. And there is no way we can, you know, we can get all this. And I did not see any NEMA official there. I did not see any Red Cross talking about Anambra State now. So it varies, and they just keep giving us this information. I don't really know the parameters.
Okay, so not knowing like the number of casualties, I wasn't saying that it's your fault, you two guys, but I'm saying that there's something lacking in the system if we can't even know the number of casualties or the number of people that have died. And I'm glad that you're addressing that. But I wanted to ask you about the reason for this flood in the first place. I'm sure that you guys are aware about the dam in Cameroon, the dam in Cameroon that broke, and also what we were supposed to, the dam that they opened, and also the fact that Nigeria was supposed to build a dam in 1982. I'm sure that you guys were aware of this. But it looks like the media in Nigeria is not really covering this, about the actual reason why the flood started. Why is that?
From the investigations I've made, you know, yes, the Director General of NIMET, you know, gets these predictions about the torrential rainfalls and all that, and gave advice to some of these states, you know, to start clearing up the drainage system and
water. Ahoma, I wasn't talking about like the rain. I'm talking about the fact that we refused to build a dam that could have, you know, taking care of some of this water that are coming into Nigeria.
Well, you see, I would not really like to start going back to why they built a dam or not, because of course you know what happened. You know, there are so many things that ought to have been done, but you see people in politics always, you know, it just goes on. We can't just keep talking about it, but how long will you keep talking about it? They're not doing anything. And you cannot even hold someone responsible. You know, you can't just hold anybody responsible. Everybody is just there doing whatever he needs. And you see that the people, the victims, are still the ordinary Nigerians, you know, ordinary people that don't even know what happened, you know. And again, the state emergency, the stakeholders there, did not really do enough work. Yes, the media as well did not raise the awareness when these predictions came. You know, because I asked some of the people I met in the camps and affected areas. They told me that some say they just read it in the papers and so it was said on television. And some of these people don't have electricity to even watch televisions. We would have gone back to the conventional method, you know, call the town crier, carry the local government along and all that. I don't think those things were done.
Okay.
I don't think those things were done. These were some of the logistics that, you know, that we had, you know, in taking care of.
Okay, so Idris, like a few days ago, some scientists in Italy were arrested because they did not predict a major earthquake that happened in Italy. Do you think that officials in Nigeria need to be held accountable about this flood? And also, which government agency would be held responsible?
I think
that was for Idris.
Idris, okay.
Okay, thanks.
I think we need to put this in a realistic perspective. The flood, the management of the flood, is a reflection of the kind of governance we are having in Nigeria. The reason why the floods are not properly managed is because the country itself is not properly managed. One of the greatest embarrassments I have felt was when the Minister of Environment came out from the Federal Executive Council meeting. The Federal Executive Council meeting is the meeting of the president and all the ministers. He came out to address the press after the meeting and said the Nigerian government had done nothing about the flood and that people were criticizing the government, were being unfair. The argument was that they had warned the victims to leave their places of abode before the floods were caused. Now, when you ask people to leave an area, are you providing for them? Hello?
Hello, I'm hearing you, Idris. Go on.
What the federal government did is to announce, like, very carefully, that they are getting the possibility of flood. They never provided relief camps on time. Some people that wanted to leave had nowhere to go to. You would be surprised to know that it wasn't until days after people were rendered homeless, sleeping on the streets after the water that taking over their property, that primary schools, secondary schools were converted to these areas. That means the government had no plan whatsoever to have permanent relief camps for this kind of issues. It was all, instead of them accepting the flood and asking, being proactive about it, what they were doing was reacting to it.
Okay.
And reacting to it, their reaction was very. So it's not just the emergency management authorities.
I'm glad that you raised up how the government has reacted, and you know, I'm about to go into that. The president said that he would raise a committee to look into giving money to the flood victims. In one of your articles about the flood, by the way, you quoted Ms. Briggs, who's like a supporter of the government from Niger Delta, and you know, she said that what we need is not money, that we have money in Nigeria, that what we need is international help. What does she mean by that? Why do we need international help in this area?
During the interview, she claimed that the various emergency authorities, both the state and the NEMA, the National Emergency Management Agency, she claimed that they are incompetent enough to manage the flood situation. And so, their challenges are not because they don't have the funds, because they lack the managerial communication. I strongly disagree with that.
Go ahead.
The truth is, I don't believe that lack of funds is the reason why. I don't believe the incompetence of the management is a reflection of the incompetence of the general leadership of the government. And so, it's not enough to see that if you say, okay, the emergency authorities are not competent, the emergency authorities come to them. You cannot say that the Nigerian president is incompetent and will bring the foreigner to Nigeria. So, it's not about bringing, it's about making decisions proactive and do the right thing at the right time.
Okay.
Like,
so,
the coming out to announce, okay.
Yeah, sorry. How am I, what do you have to say about that? Why do we always have to have international help to rescue us in everything if we have an emergency management council? Do you agree with that we still need help from other countries to take care of this, or we need to equip the emergency management council that we have?
I would answer that question by, you know, asking how long are we going to be going out, you know, to be asking for international help, assistance, and all that. Why don't we put our house in order? You know, that's the bottom line. These things keep reoccurring. And let me tell you now, it might happen again in the next 5 years, and you still see the same things going on and on. Why do we keep recycling? If somebody is not really good at his job, that person should get fired. That bottom line, fire that person, get people out there. But they keep telling you, yeah, this one is the best, this one. Then again,
okay,
all talk show as far as I'm concerned, you know. So it's high time we start putting, you know,
yeah. Briefly, because of our time, I know that you were in the Niger Delta covering this flood. I just want to hear how that was like, because the Niger Delta has already been polluted by oil. So on top of that, now they have the flood. So what is the impact of, you know, having the flood where they already have the oil? I mean, is it going to, will they take the oil to other places apart? I mean, the oil pollution, will they take it to other places apart from the Niger Delta? I mean, what is going on in Niger Delta?
Adela, with what I saw, I think with this just the some phases, this flood will come in phases. I think I'm more worried what will happen, you know, after we pass through, you know, this particular phase we are now. People are really suffering. You know, people are really suffering. When I went to the camp at Yenagoa, sports complex, you see the way so many kids were there, women all lying there, people that are looking very hopeless. You know, these are just people that don't even know how to start their life again. I met a woman that told me everything she's labored for is just there. The house just collapsed. And now, what are we talking about? You know, the government is just, as far as I'm concerned, they're just giving them hopes and all that. But how sure are these people that they are going to, like, make good the promises they are being, they are making to them now? For the pollution, well, that has been an age-long thing, you know. But this is more than oil pollution or that, because it affected mainly ordinary Nigerians, you know, ordinary their livelihood, where their shelter and their health, education, everywhere, everything is just affected, you know. And I see. The coming days to be even more disastrous than what we're seeing now.
We're actually coming to talk about briefly about the aftermath of the flood, but quickly, Idris, what is your reaction to the president's response to this flood? Do you think it was adequate? I mean, he's saying that he's setting up a committee. Do we have to wait for disasters before we set up committees, and what do you think about his reaction to this flood in general?
You know, after listening to the presidential broadcast on the flood, I felt ashamed as a Nigerian that I listened to my president's speech on the morning and I got nothing from it. Now, he set up a committee to raise funds. Taking the picture as if the fact that the reason why you are in the setting is because you don't have funds to do so, which is not true. It is not true because Nigeria is richly blessed, like we all know, and the money emerging, because the money that was given to Ghana to take a loan from the Malawi scandal, nobody only has 50 billion naira. It would have been used to take care of everybody that suffered from the flood. So even setting up money, committee to raise money for the flood is an embarrassment.
And speaking about that money, do you know? Has there been any follow up? Do you know if people have received money from the government?
They are not. The money is not going to be given to the victims directly in the first instance. They don't like sharing money to the victims. I think what they're trying to do now, at the initial stage, is to make sure they provide enough material for the victims while they are in camp. And then when the flood recedes completely, they can then use the money to help people to kickstart their lives back. So they're not like sharing money to victims of the flood yet.
Okay, so, say your second, the second thing you wanted to say the other time before I cut you off. You were saying that secondly.
I can't remember, but there's something very important I think I need to mention.
Yeah, go ahead.
That was given by Nema. Nema has warned that the present flood being witnessed in Nigeria is going to be small compared to what we witnessed in the next 3 years. When another dam in Cameroon, Lake Nyos, which has been predicted by all experts, to collapse the next, to have problems in the next 3 years. So, Nema said at least 1 million people will die from the tragedy in the next 3 years if proactive actions are not taken. Now, Nema has given the warning. They say within the next 3 years. It could happen in the next 6 months. It could happen in the next 1 year. It could happen in the next 3 years. The government, as I talked to you today, has not started active practice to prevent that disaster. Now, God forbid, if what Nema has wanted to be done are not done now, God forbid, the next 1 year, without the President's Technical Standard Committee to manage disaster that would have been hundreds of thousands of people.
Okay.
The warning has come in early enough and nobody is doing anything on it.
So this is not the end of the flood. There is still more to come and we are not prepared. Okay. So quickly, Ahoma, what are some of the aftermath that we can expect from this flood?
I would first of all, recommend that all the commissioners of environment for the affected state, the affected state should first of all be fired. Lagos State was among it was the only state that took the precaution, that took it seriously, and look at how they managed the death. You understand? So we see it's not as if we need assistance from heaven. Lagos State managed the flood very well. You know, that is the first step. Then I think the media has a lot to do here. Whenever Nema, any of the give this prediction, I think we have to, shout it to the rooftops, We have to, be very, very proactive, let the people know, because at the end of the day, we are the ones that are supposed to be talking to them. I wouldn't want to start, trading planes with Nema. That's their problem. But as a journalist, I think I have a duty, to inform my Nana that I'm appealing to all my fellow journalists in Nigeria. Let's do this job with a human face. Let's have the people at heart. Let's go out there and make sure that yes, we can avert something like maybe not in street structures or properties, but the lives that's been lost. We could have done better.
All right. Thank you so much, guys, for joining us today and talking about this. I really appreciate you coming on. Because we're running out of time, I have to end this. But I'm hoping that there would be a change, that the media in Nigeria will pay more attention to this and actually do more stories and more coverage, especially of what's going on in the camp. And also that people will get to know some of the things to expect after the flood, like some sicknesses or, that could follow because of what has happened with the flood. Okay, so that has been our highlight segment today about the flood. So Idris and Haoma, thanks a lot for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Diola.
Thank you very much.
All right. So, viewers, that has been Idris and Ahoma, journalists from Nigeria, talking to us about the coverage of the flood that has been going on in Nigeria. Stay tuned. We have our shows coming up, Dr. Damages, and also Keeping It Real with Adiola. We'll be right back.
If you're not informed,
if you don't know where you come from, you will never find where you're going.
When Nigeria is working, we will all know.
PDP and us are diametrically opposed.
Information, education, inspiration. SaharaTV.
I am from SaharaTV. I'd like to ask you a few questions.
Information, education.